Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in amma ba'd. Fa'a'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajeem, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'idhatil hasana, wa jadilhum billati hi ahsan, inna rabbaka huwa a'lamu biman dhalla an sabilihi, wa huwa a'lamu bil muhtadeen. SadaqAllahu al-Aliyun Azeem. My dear respected, most honorable elders, beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. First and foremost, we begin by humbly thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by glorifying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for enabling us with this opportunity to come together to increase in our knowledge of His Quran and the Sunnah of His beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to glorify, to praise him and to send salutations upon his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we pray that Allah Azza wa Jal will continue to facilitate these kind of wonderful opportunities for us in the future, inshaAllah. I must apologize to begin with. I'm feeling a little bit under the weather. So if you hear or see me sneezing or blowing my nose, please do excuse me. The classes still have to go on. So, irrespective of our condition, inshallah, we're going to continue to try and educate each other, learn off one another, and attempt to increase in our good work, especially during this beloved month. The title of today's topic is Dawah and the Tenderness of the Prophetic Approach, or Dawah and the Gentleness of the Prophetic Approach. Because the prophetic approach to da'wah and spreading the message has always been a tender or a gentle one. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was never harsh-hearted and severe in his da'wah. It was always done with a lot of gentleness and a lot of compassion. In order for us to talk about the prophetic approach, it's important for us to first and foremost understand what da'wah is. Da'wah is something that is obligatory on every Muslim. We are obligated to call people to Islam by enjoining good and forbidding evil, by calling people towards khair and prohibiting them or forbidding them from doing that which is regarded as shar or evil. Those who hold Islam to be correct, recognize themselves as da'is. And each and every one of us is a da'i. You know, a da'i isn't just an individual who stands on a street corner preaching about Islam, or a da'wah man or a da'wah woman. No, a da'i is each and every one of us. We are all da'is. We're all enjoining good and forbidding evil. We all have a responsibility, a collective responsibility, to invite people towards Islam through our own actions. And inshallah, we'll talk about that as we go on. The reason why I talk about this, and I've chosen this as a topic, is because we often hear that sort of statement that, you know, actions speak louder than words, and it's a strong saying. Actions do indeed speak louder than words. Throughout history, there are countless examples of empty words, of inaction, which have led to the masses losing trust in the leader or the speaker. Because if you say something, or encourage someone to do something that you're unwilling to do yourself, then people are not going to be inspired by you. Whereas if you take action, that's naturally going to encourage or inspire people to do the same thing, to follow you in that particular action. When you have those empty words and that type of inaction, it leads to people losing trust. That person doesn't only lose trust in you, they lose trust in the entire mission, in the entire statement. So if I'm telling people to do good and to speak the truth, but I'm constantly lying myself, people are not only going to not believe in me, but they're not going to believe in the message. And although the message would have been correct that I was trying to convey, they're going to be drawn away and pushed away from the message altogether. So when one embarks upon this message of da'wah, it's imperative that not only must they convey the truth, they should also pair that message with proper, appropriate action. So when you talk about a da'wah man and a da'wah woman talking about Islam and conveying the right message, that has to be backed up with the proper action in place. So you too have to be an embodiment of that which you're preaching. We hear this statement, look at Islam, don't look at Muslims. Look at Islam, don't look at the Muslims. This is another coined phrase by us to sort of, you know, as if to take blame away from us and say, look, you know, when you look at the state of Islam today, it's not Islam, it's Muslims. Don't look at the Muslims when you want to know about Islam. Look at the religion itself. And this is a ridiculous statement, because Muslims are supposed to be an embodiment of Islam and its principles. And sadly, this phrase has become an all too common sight. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he won the hearts of the people through his exceptional standard of character. It was his morality that took the people out of darkness and brought them into the light, to such an extent that even his enemies, they had to admit that he was a man of impeccable moral character, impeccable morality and characteristics. And Muslims need to be that. We need to have that exemplary character, so that when non-Muslims begin to judge Islam by the people who adhere to it, and that media image that they have, that the media has portrayed of Islam, that's naturally going to be dissipated, because they're going to look at Islam and say, well, actually, no, Muslims are not like that, because I have a Muslim neighbor and Zayd, and he's an excellent human being. He's a wonderful man. So I don't believe what people are saying about Muslims on the media, because I know I've met Muslims and I know what they're like. But if on the other hand, we enforce that stereotype by being the type of individuals that they're seeing on their TV screens, then they're going to say, of course they're liars, they're cheaters, and they're aggressive individuals. Look at them. This is how they're behaving on the streets. That's how they truly are, the way they're being conveyed. So it's, you know, we can't expect, when people say, look at Islam and don't look at the Muslims. You know, when a Muslim wants to know more about your Prophet, and he's heard about our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do you think, you know, he's going to open up Sirah ibn Hisham or Sirah ibn Ishaq? He's going to think, well, I need to know more. Let's research into what biographies have been written about this man so I can read and know more about him. No, they're just going to look at his representatives, the Muhammadans. They're going to look at you and I and then judge the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam according to our actions and according to our behavior with them. And that's a really a magnificent responsibility, that you are a representative of the individual who was impeccable, who was perfect in every single way. That's what we're doing. We're following perfection. And it's difficult to follow that type of, it's impossible to follow that type of perfection. But we must show that this is who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. You know, effective da'wah. And it's important that type of da'wah is done always in a gentle and a loving manner. Not the street preachers that I've already spoken about. Those street preachers who are constantly shouting and screaming at the top of their voices till their lungs burst, saying, you're all going to hell, Islam is the only way, you're going to hell, you're going to hell, you're going to... No! How's that going to inspire people to listen to you and to look at the message with open eyes, with open ears, with an open mind? That's not going to happen. They're just going to run away from you. They're going to disband from you. So it's important that you do so in a gentle and loving manner, because the best way to give da'wah is to plant a seed in someone's heart. The purpose of da'wah should never be to convert people. I hear, you know, these kind of preachers coming online and talking about, oh well, you know, I've converted 200 people to Islam. No, you haven't done anything to convert. Allah has converted them. Allah has you planted that seed through the blessings that Allah gave to you. Allah put you in that position. So don't think it was you that converted 200. You didn't do nothing. You didn't do nothing. You just fulfilled your obligation. Your obligation was to convey the message to them. And if the message was attractive and they accepted it, then alhamdulillah, you're going to be rewarded. But don't go around saying you converted them. Allah inspired them. So the purpose of da'wah should never be to convert people. Oh, it's like getting notches on your belt.
Oh, I want to convert as many people. He's converted 30, I want to convert 50. That's just ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Our intention is becoming muddled nowadays. You know, that goal is going to scare people away, if nothing else. Instead, you know, when we plant a seed in a person's heart, when we look at da'wah as planting a seed in a person's heart, you know, we're going to leave that person wanting more. So instead of enforcing the religion on them, and we see that through preachers nowadays, through jamaats that go to people's homes and try to enforce them with a message and just bombard them with information, that's never going to work, right? When you bombard people with information, it's information. Oh, look, you've got a computer, right? I've got an iPad in front of me. If I try to open up as many tabs as possible, and I overwork this computer, this machine, what's going to happen? It's going to go into information overload. What's going to happen when it goes into information overload? What's going to happen, Zakir Sahib? It's going to stop working, it's going to crash. And that's exactly what's going to happen when you overload information, albeit the right information regarding the Quran and the Sunnah, into a person's mind. They're going to go into information overload. They're just not ready to see the religion in the manner that you're trying to convey it to them. So it has to be done little by little, planting a seed, you know, giving tastes, and people will accept. That's how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't just come out and say, well, I'm the messenger of Allah, you're all going to hell, unless you believe in me, you have to leave this, leave that, leave that, leave that. No, everything was done in stages. Even the prohibition of alcohol, which is haram, was done in stages so that people could get used to it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understood the mentality and the weakness of insan, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ دَعِيفًا, that insan has been created weak. So that constant barrage of unattractive, scary speech is going to drive people away, whereas sometimes you don't even need to speak. You don't even need to speak. Your character and personality speaks for itself, and that kind of da'wah is considerably more effective. And we see that in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't need to speak at times. His actions and his aura, his personality was enough to inspire people to accept the message. And that's when we look at the great awliya of the past, we'll find. Amazing examples of individuals who inspired people through their character first and foremost, and then their words came second. So plant that seed of interest and curiosity in a person's heart. And what's going to happen is, instead of you bombarding them with information, they're going to be inquisitive and ask you for more. They're going to come back wanting more. So it's important that we do that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the verse of the Quran that I quoted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'izatil hasana." That invite people towards the way of your Lord with hikmah, with wisdom and gentle preaching. So this is gentle preaching. Gentle preaching we've already touched on, right? That effective da'wah in terms of planting a seed in a person's heart. Being a person of good character, of good morality, that's going to inspire others. But what about wisdom? What is wisdom? This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions wisdom side by side because both of them are synonymous with one another, effective preaching and wisdom, because wisdom includes intelligence, it includes tajriba, it includes experience, it includes insight, foresight, firasa, it includes perception, it includes understanding all in one. Because sometimes you may have the information, but you don't know how to convey that information. Wisdom is the one that gives you the tools in order to convey that information in the right way. That's why it's different from knowledge. Knowledge is about facts and ideas that we acquire through research and through study, through investigation, through observation or experience. Whereas wisdom is the ability to discern and judge which knowledge is applicable in which situation, whatever the situation is. So you know what type. That's It's perfectly reminiscent of the character of the personality and the personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he knew what to state. You know, when he says that I've been blessed with six things that other prophets before me weren't given, and he talks about jawami al-kalam, The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being given words that are concise and yet comprehensive in meaning. That's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes he needed to say very little. Other times he needed to say a little bit more. But he conveyed his message in a manner that at that moment in time people understood. Sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would adopt silence. And that was the most wisest thing to do at the time. And this is something that we need to sort of bring back into our lexicon and our understanding. But wisdom isn't always what it seems though, is it? Because wisdom is something that develops over time. Up until the 3rd century BC, and even beyond it. In fact, up until the 14th and 15th, some even the 16th century, and some even today, believed that the earth is flat, and believed that the earth was flat. And later, philosophers and scientists discovered that to be false. For those of you who have studied a little bit of science, I try to read a little bit, the little that I can. Geocentricity is a belief that existed in the past. It's the belief that the earth is the center of the universe, right? So because people saw the stars, the sun and the moon revolving around the earth, they believed that the earth was immobile, that it stayed in one place and everything else was mobile, revolving around the earth. And this was universally embraced in ancient Greek and in ancient China. And this idea was supported by the fact that all of these things were moving around and revolving around the earth, whereas the physical perception was that the earth is immobile and it's not moving. And that geocentric model was eventually displaced with the work of scientists like Copernicus, of Galileo and Kepler. These individuals, they figured out and they conveyed the message that no, it's, the earth is also in motion, it's also moving and it's not the center, and everything else is not revolving around the earth. So that so sometimes it can be possible that conventional wisdom is not something that Islam regards as being wise. Right? Because that was conventional wisdom back then, that the earth was flat, there was a geocentric model. If you disbelieved in that, or you tried to disprove that, you were considered as unwise. Right? So it's not always that conventional wisdom is always seen as correct. Nowadays, you can look at the example and compare it to now. Conventional wisdom, universal wisdom, states that, men can get married to men and women can get married to women, or women can be men and men can be women. There's no set gender specifics. They can interlap. There's certain, our religion is disputed. It's an unwise to believe that there's a God. It's unwise now, because if you believe in a God, you're a mythical type of, you're a believer in something that is mythical or magical, and that goes against the conventional wisdom, which is that the theory of evolution, man was descended from a non-human organism or non-human species, whereas there's nobody else, there was no divine being there that created the first to begin with. You know, so it's important for us to understand that not always is conventional wisdom correct. Both are synonymous with one another. You've got the knowledge, you have to have the conventional, the wisdom to go with it. And that's where the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes in. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. So remind them, O Muhammad, because you are only a reminder. The greatest da'i was the noble example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For 40 years prior to the revelation, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had 40 years among them. They were 40 years of da'wah. They weren't just 40 years of doing nothing. Those 40 years were in no way insignificant. The significance of those 40 years can never ever be understated, because those 40 years were practice and leading up to that point when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed in his message at the age of 40. Those 40 years were 40 years of experience, of tajriba, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gained, better perception that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a better understanding that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began to gain and improve over time. So those 40 years led up to that moment when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated that there is no God but Allah and that he is the messenger of Allah. For 40 years he was known as As-Sadiq wal-Ameen, the most truthful and the most trustworthy one. And the fact that he was given this name can only mean one of two things: that either his honesty and his trustworthy nature surpassed all others, or at the time it was so rare to find someone who was that unique, that had those unique qualities of being honest and truthful, and therefore his nature was regarded as unique and it was treasured as such. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she was asked about what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's akhlaq and his morality was like, she said, "Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an." His akhlaq were like the Quran. He was a walking, talking version of the Quran. If the Quran said do this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it. If the Quran says don't do this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi salatu wasallam forbade it, and he prohibited it, and he didn't engage in himself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself states that not only was I sent to teach you good character, innama bu'ithtu li'utammima makarim al-akhlaq, O salih al-akhlaq, that I have been sent to perfect good character for you, to show you the perfect manifestation of what good character is, then you can learn from it. So you know, when you're looking at, it's Ramadan time and iftar time is coming, and you're looking at recipes, someone's perfected a recipe, so they show you the perfect representation of that recipe and you try to imitate it in a way. That's like us imitating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We can never have the characteristics that the Prophet had in exactly the same way. We can't be as truthful and as trustworthy as him. We can't be as wise and as knowledgeable as him. No, but we can imitate him in the best way that we can. And that's where the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes in. Because we're only imitating that individual. And people talk about, oh well, why should we need to imitate him? We've got the Quran. The Quran says, do this and don't do this and do this and don't do that. So why do we need the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to imitate? But it's the same Quran that you guys are using to tell us that we shouldn't follow the Prophet, that tells us and enjoins that. It encourages that. Not only encourages it, it obligates that. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And in the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have indeed a great moral character. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. And in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you have the best of morality and the best of character. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala, and he served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam for 10 years. He was with him day in and day out, both when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam traveled and when he was a resident in Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was knowledgeable with regards to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's character and his personality. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, answer this, Ibrahim. He says, listen to what he said, having spent all of that time with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. He said, قال لم يكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاحشا ولا لعانا ولا سبابا. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not swear at anyone. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never rude. He did not curse anyone. كَانَ يَكُونُ عِنْدِ الْمَأْتَبَةِ مَا لَهُ تَرِبَ جَبِينُ. If he desired to reprimand someone, he would simply say, مَا لَهُ تَرِبَ جَبِينُ. What's wrong with him? May dust be cast in his face. Listen to this verse of the Quran. When I said about being harsh-hearted and being severe in your speech and what it leads people to do, it leads people to run away from you. The Quran in Surah Al-Imran, which is the third chapter of the Quran, verse 159, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and listen to this verse, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. So by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Muhammad, لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. You are lenient towards them. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَدُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. That if you had been rude in speech and harsh in heart, they would have disbanded from you. They would have run away from you. فَعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. So therefore, ask forgiveness from them and consult. Pardon them, ask forgiveness from them and consult them in the matter. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَىٰهُ. And when you've decided, then rely upon Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who rely on Him truly. So this is what Allah is saying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you were lenient towards them. If you were harsh-hearted, if you were rude, like we are to each other, and think that in some way we're inspiring people towards the message by shouting and screaming at the top of our voices, by our speech being unattractive, by never smiling. Look at the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was smiling all the time. The companions state that we knew nobody who smiled more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his smile was infectious. And look at us, when we see our religious leaders now with stern looks on their faces, never smiling, never inspiring with their character and their personality, and thinking that their words are enough to conquer the hearts of the people. That's not what's going to happen. And that's certainly not what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam expected from his message. If the message alone was supposed to be sufficient, enough as a guidance or as inspiration, then there would be no need for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah and his character and his characteristics. Inshallah, I think we've only got a minute or two left, so I don't want to go through. I wanted to actually focus on how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was wise, and how his character was one of which was morally upright. Like in terms of correcting people's mistakes, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that. Now I've got examples from that. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would try to make things easy and not be difficult. How he was so approachable as a religious, as the greatest human being, yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so approachable. Nowadays we've got the celebrity culture surrounding religious scholars, that they're completely unapproachable. That celebrity status has blown the ego into the stratosphere. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would use firmness when it's time to use firmness. When it was time for him to be firm, he was firm. When it was time for him to be soft, he was soft. How he used to spare people's dignity. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sympathetic, or he was empathetic of people's emotions and feelings. How he never reminded them of their lapses in the past, of their mistakes in the past, but he was quick to recall their good deeds. Inshallah, I'm going to talk about that tomorrow. Although tomorrow's topic is different, but we haven't completed this, and I really want to go through this. So we'll have to find a time. Maybe on Salat al-Jum'ah this week, we can go through this, the rest of this lesson. It can be sort of a part two to today's talk, because those practical examples, you know, we built up the groundwork leading up to this, and it's important that we try to explain that with the practical examples of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he was the greatest da'i. Inshallah, we'll cover that again. I'll try to get that done tomorrow. Perhaps beforehand, we'll try to have two classes tomorrow. Maybe we can do that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you the tawfiq and the ability to act upon the teachings of the Quran, the noble sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I want to take this opportunity to thank all of our brothers and sisters who donated to the Jami' al-Karam appeal yesterday. £160,000 was pledged, which is a huge sum. I think it's the largest that any appeal to date has garnered. And that has only been made possible, first and foremost, with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and secondly, through the du'as and the well wishes and the support of people like you. This is an institution that, like I mentioned in the Facebook post yesterday, it's an institution that I'm deeply indebted to for providing that framework for me to go and become what I wanted to be, and to study what I wanted to study. Those 8 years, that formal education from 1999 to 2007, it can never be understated. Those relationships that were molded during that time, they exist to this day, especially the ones that we have with our teachers, to such an extent that I went on to study for many years after that in other institutions, in Jamat al-Azhar, as well as other institutions. Those teachers that I had in Al-Karam, for some reason, they could not be surpassed. the effect and the impact that they had was far more reaching. And that's because of what we're talking about today. It's not necessarily got to do with what knowledge they were conveying. It's how they were conveying that knowledge, with what character and personality that they had. Their character was reminiscent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were true representatives of the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. And we pray for our noble founder of Jami al-Karam, Shaykh Rizwan Hussain, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a long life, and Allah azza wa jal continue to keep him with us, so that we can be inspired by him. For no doubt he's one of the most inspirational people certainly that I've come across. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you the tawfiq and the ability to act upon the teachings of the Quran, the noble sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and learn as much as we can from these blessed inheritors of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.